Hello there, morning to you. Good to see you at Flemington Hallside Parish Church Sunday service. Ian Cathcart, the minister, and we're doing it online. Who knows for how much longer? Not sure. But basically, we have one more I am seeing, and I'm not sure if you're supposed to have favourites. The fact is, I think this, is it my favourite? It's hard to say. We're going to be looking at I Am the Bread of Life. And it's just one I was going to say to get your teeth into, but that's obviously, I was actually thinking about that, but that's a bit too much. The fact is, we're going to start with some verses from Psalm 34. I will bless the Lord at all times. His praise shall continually be in my mouth. My soul makes its boast in the Lord. O magnify the Lord with me, and let us exalt his name together. Taste and see that the Lord is good. Blessed is the man who takes refuge in him. The young lions suffer want and hunger, but those who seek the Lord lack no good thing. We're here to focus on his word, but we're here fundamentally to worship his name. And we're going to start by singing, I don't know if it's your favourite, but I know it's a favourite of a lot of folks. We're going to start by singing, How Great Thou Art.
O Lord my God, when I in awesome wonder consider all the worlds thy hands have made, I see the stars, I hear the rolling thunder, thy power throughout the universe displayed. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee, how great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee, how great thou art, how great thou art. When through the woods and forest glades I wander and hear the birds sing sweetly in the trees, when I look down from lofty mountain grandeur and hear the brook and feel the gentle breeze, then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee, how great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee, how great thou art, how great thou art. And when I think that God, his Son not sparing, sent him to die, I scarce can take it in. That on a cross, my burdens gladly bearing, he bled and died to take away my sin. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee, how great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to Thee. How great Thou art, how great Thou art. And when Christ shall come, with shout of acclamation, and take me home, what joy shall fill my heart. Then I shall bow in humble adoration, and there proclaim, my God, how great Thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to Thee. How great Thou art, how great Thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to Thee. How great Thou art, how great Thou art, how great Thou art, how great Thou art.
Join me as we pray together. Let's pray. Father God, we thank you for giving us our daily needs, for the food we have, for the shelter that we live under, for our friends, for our family, for the chance to work. Father, we thank you for these daily needs that you meet. We thank you too for this glorious world. We thank you for all of nature. We thank you for the majestic mountains and the wildlife. Help us to pause and see your handiwork more clearly as we go about our daily business. We thank you for the NHS and all the people who work in that organisation. Thanks for the doctors and the nurses and the porters and the admin staff and everyone else associated with the organisation, which has so well looked after so many ill people in recent months. We thank you for all the work that goes on there and for the continuation of that work. We thank you for the police as well and all that they've had to do recently with the lockdown slowly easing and all the things that people are beginning to be able to do again, and sometimes maybe going a little bit too far. We ask for the police to be given patience with people. We ask for them to be given the ability to calm situations which could become heated. Thank you that the battle against this virus is beginning to be won here in Scotland. We know there's a long way to go, but we thank you that that battle is beginning to be won. We thank you for our church family, for those that pray for people day in, day out in our church, for those who look out for one another each and every day and week in these difficult times. We thank you for all those people and for that church community that we have. And we thank you for our wider community in Halfway and Cambers Lang and all through our parish. We thank you for all those people. Help us too to be a church who reach out to those people who are in need in our parish. But we thank you for Jesus most of all. We thank you that you sent him to this world to suffer in our place. And we thank you, Jesus, for being willing to do that. And as we do that, we also confess. We confess that there have been times when we've got it really badly wrong. We confess that we have not always believed like we should. We've not always been as kind as we should. We're sorry for letting you down, Lord, when we should be following your ways. When we wander from your path and we stand in awe of the world instead of standing in awe of you. Forgive us. Forgive us for our selfishness. Forgive us for our anger that's unrighteous. Forgive us when we're unfair rather than fair with people. Forgive us when we don't treat people the way we should and the way we'd like to be treated ourselves. Forgive us, Lord, when we get it wrong. And we ask all these things in Jesus' name. Amen.
Well, good morning, everyone. It's really good to see you all. Well, at least you can see me. I make that same joke every time. Anyway, it's not really that funny. Anyway, this morning, we're here to think about bread. Cora, do you like bread?
Yeah.
Yeah? Well, we've got some bread in front of us here. Would you like to taste some?
Yeah.
And tell us what your favourite is. Yeah. Okay. But before we do that, will we pray?
Yeah.
Okay, let's pray then. Ready? Dear Lord Jesus, thank you that we are still able to meet together, even though we're not together. Thank you that we are able to see more people outside and we're able to travel to see more of your wonderful creation. Help us to focus now to hear what you want to say to us. Amen. Right. Now said a prayer, will we have some food? Some bread? Right, okay. Right. You want to have some of this one? What's this? Well, a wee bit of croissant. Do you want to see what you think of that? You can take a bite, because it's yours anyway. I'll have a wee bit. That's nice, isn't it? Okay, right, what have we got next? We've got a cob. Do you want to a wee bit of the cob? Do you like that? Okay. Now we've got ciabatta. Okay, you like that too, yeah? Okay, and then we've got one that I made yesterday. Tomato and herbs. Oh, you, do you want a wee break to eat that? Maybe give you that one next. We'll give you that one next. Okay, this is a little bit of brioche. You'll like that one, won't you? And finally, this one. You take it in your hand just now. So, today we're thinking about bread. It's a lovely loaf of bread here, nice and crusty on the outside and soft on the inside. Looks really good. Now, we're thinking about bread today, while Cora eats that, because Jesus said, I am the bread of life. Now, that's a bit of a funny thing to say, isn't it? Cora, which one's your favourite? The chocolate chip brioche.
That one.
Them all. You like them all?
Yeah.
Well, that's really good. Now tell me this. Would you prefer chocolate or bread? Do you see which one you prefer? Chocolate. Would you prefer chips or bread?
Chips.
Would you prefer ice lollies or bread?
Ice lollies.
Would you prefer sweets or bread?
Sweets.
Now, Cora said sweets and she said chips and she said chocolate and all the nice things, but there's one thing about bread that these other things don't have, and that is that bread can give us more energy and nutrients than all these other things, because they slowly release the energy that we need rather than quickly like sugar, and they produce lots of energy for us. So bread helps to sustain us longer. And Jesus said he was the bread of life, which meant that he can sustain us. And that means that we don't need anything else. Why Jesus said that was because he was trying to say to everybody that he was enough for everybody. And just like we sometimes enjoy a bit of chocolate and we enjoy a bit of all these nice things, but they don't really sustain us in the way that bread does. We all try lots of different things, like, you know, going out and watching films or play sport or all these other things to try and make us happy and keep us going in life and get a good job and all these things. And all these things are good, but we try and fill our lives with all these things, and actually the only thing that truly sustains and fills us up and keeps us going is Jesus. And so no matter how much we try to fill that gap with other things, it's just not going to work. And that's why Jesus compared himself to bread. And it's also, when we think about bread, we think about the Last Supper, and Jesus said that when you eat this bread, you know, you do so in remembrance of me, because this is my body broken for you, and the sacrifice that he made. So bread's has quite a lot of thoughts, quite a lot of things to think about when we think about bread. And Jesus said that he was like bread, and then sacrificed himself. So actually he became the living bread. So remember this week, and maybe think about who you can share that with. When you're trying to fill your life with all lots of things and all these different things, remember that actually our focus should be on Jesus, trying to do what he wants us to do and live our life the way he wants us to live. And actually we'll maybe find that our life, everything else in life, fall into place, because Jesus says he was all that we need. And so if we put him first, we'll maybe find that we don't actually want or need anything else. Now, I hope you have a great week. Maybe this week you could have a look at your family pack, and in the family pack this week there's some recipes for some different breads and things like that. Maybe you could just make sandwiches together and put lots of different fillings, or maybe you could try some of the recipes and make some of your own bread with your whoever's at home, the adults at home. And then maybe you could post some of the pictures of them onto the Facebook page to let us see some of the things that you've made. That would be fantastic. We're going to finish with a wee prayer, and then I'm handing over to the next thing, which will probably be the Bible reading. So, here we go. Dear God, thank you that you are the bread of life. Thank you that you are all we need. Help us to remember that and to put you first. Help us to share that with other people this week. Amen.
Good morning. Today we finish our series on the I Am of Jesus, and it's one of the best. This is from Gospel of John, chapter 6, starting at verse 26. Hear the word of God. Jesus said, "Don't work for food that spoils. Work for food that gives eternal life. The Son of Man will give you this food, because God the Father has given him the right to do so." What exactly does God want us to do? The people asked. Jesus answered, "God wants you to have faith in the one he sent." They replied, "What miracle will you work so that we can have faith in you? What will you do? For example, when our ancestors were in the desert, they were given manna to eat. It happened just as the scriptures say, God gave them bread from heaven to eat. He sent me and wants to make certain that none of the ones he has given me will be lost. Instead, he wants me to raise them to life on the last day. My Father wants everyone who sees the Son to have faith in him and to have eternal life. Then I will raise them to life on the last day." The people started grumbling because Jesus had said he was the bread that had come down from heaven. They were asking each other, "Isn't he Jesus, the son of Joseph? Don't we know his father and mother? How can he say that he has come down from heaven?" Jesus told them, "Stop grumbling. No one can come to me unless the Father who sent me makes them want to come. But if they do come, I will raise them to life on the last day. One of the prophets wrote, God will teach all of them. Jesus told them, I tell you for certain that Moses wasn't the one who gave the bread from heaven. My Father is the one who gives you the true bread from heaven and the bread that God gives. This is one who came down from heaven to give life to the world. The people said, Lord, give us this bread and don't ever stop. Jesus replied, I am the bread that gives life. No one who comes to me will be hungry. No one who has faith in me will ever be thirsty. I have told you already that you have seen me and still do not have faith in me. Everything and everyone that the Father has given me will come to me. I won't turn any of them away. I don't come from heaven to do what I want. I come to do what the Father wants me to do. And so anyone who listens to the Father and learns from him will come to me. The only one who has seen the Father is the one who has come from him. No one else has ever seen the Father. I tell you for certain that everyone who has faith in me has eternal life. I am the bread that gives life. Your ancestors ate manna in the desert and later they died. But the bread from heaven has come down so that no one who eats it will ever die. I am that bread from heaven. Everyone who eats it will live forever. My flesh is life-giving bread that I give to people of this world. Amen. And may Jesus help us think and reflect on this classic symbol of bread of life. And may we take the strength that God intends us to take from it, especially in this tough time. Now back to Ian with this morning's message.
Thank you very much indeed to Bailey for that. And to that end, thank you to Ross and to Cora. Thank you. Apologies. And thank you to Stuart as well. Glad you're all there. What's your favourite thing to eat? It's one of those... It's not everyone who's the same, but when you do get somebody's favourite thing, whether it's, you know, Indian or Chinese, or whether it's kind of traditional Scottish fare, food does tend to motivate people in a way that few things do. So having got you to the point where you're thinking about all of that, can I suggest that there is never ever a passage where the illustration of the culture that we're in and the culture that they're in are really quite separate. So I know there's lots of people who come and say you have to understand the context and the culture out of which this passage comes. What I'm saying is, when you ask somebody their favourite meal, increasingly nowadays, the answer, whatever it might be, illustrates the fact that we all live, usually, in an urban, industrialised, global economy. And so what you eat will tend to be quite varied. Now, you might say it all comes out of a supermarket and so it all tastes the same, but I'm just saying... The one thing that really does dominate people's diets now is the apparent variety. And the other thing that dominates the a description or a descriptive word, things are very, very processed. The whole concept of things being in season is now largely irrelevant. If you want your strawberries in December, you'll get them. You'll pay more for them. The point is, the fact that they don't come from the Clyde Valley in the middle of winter, that reflects our country and its season, but it's in season somewhere else, and it will get probably flown in. My point is, all of those points illustrate how different we are from what Jesus' time is. It was a non-industrial, local, non-processed, agrarian, small town microeconomy. And in this particular situation, probably maritime economy, as in fish would have featured quite a lot because of its proximity to the Lake of Galilee. What all of that basically means is food would have been less varied. Meat would have been much more indicative of the fact that there was a festival on. It didn't mean it was Saturday night and you got a takeaway. Our food worlds are very different. So you have to understand their culture and their context. In a passage like this, you have to recognize how significant just the whole concept of bread would actually have been. Recognize that even in the capital city of the Roman Empire, when the various emperors had their killing spree in the Colosseum, the warm-up acts, or sometimes the bits in between, where people in wagons going round the Colosseum throwing loaves of bread into the audience, because it was everywhere, but a really good quality loaf was something that people sought after. So it's that basic understanding that in their culture, bread was such a defining thing. If you had it, it sustained you. It is an amazing thing that people with not much can actually get by on bread and one or two other things. But bread sustains in a way that very, very few other foods down through antiquity can compete with. It's just this defining food. If you have it, you'll survive. If you don't have it, you'll starve. So that's the kind of wider context. What's the specific context? Well, in this particular chapter, to begin with, Jesus does the feeding of the 5,000 men. And so they all appear in the passage that Bailey read for us, and they all appear because they've already seen the day before the miracle that he did with some bread and some fish. And what you get from what Jesus says is a very clear recognition. They saw the miracle, but they didn't get the significance of the miracle. They got the bread. They didn't get the point. And so pretty much the whole of this passage is, have you got it yet? Have you got it? It's this perennial problem. Miracles wrench people out of their humdrum everyday reality and make them look at Jesus and they go, what did Jesus do? In other words, it makes them stop and stare, but it's not, miracles don't really help when it comes to understanding. In other words, this may be symbolic, but they don't get that. And so this passage is essentially a follow-on, it's an application of the fact that Jesus did the miracle of the feeding the 5,000 with bread and fish, but he focuses on bread. So that's why in the kind of opening stages, Billy read it out and said, the verse that says, do not work for food that spoils, but work for food that endures. In other words, I've already given you the food that spoils. I've given you bread. And that was good. But you've all just come and set yourself in front of us now looking for another miracle. You want a full stomach. Don't focus on the stuff that goes into your stomach. Focus on the stuff that nourishes your soul. That's what he's saying. Don't work for food that spoils. So they obviously ask, well, what do we have to do? What work do we have to do to get that food that doesn't spoil? And Jesus says, you have to believe in the one whom God has sent. In all of the, one of the recurring feature in all of these I am statements, Jesus is not backward at coming forward. You know, Mary and Martha are in grief. Do you believe in the resurrection? Yes, I do. Yes. Well, I am the resurrection and the life. We come to this passage where it's, what's it all about? Well, actually, Jesus says it's all about me. He really is quite an arrogant individual. He's quite full of himself. Unless, however, he's just stating a factual truth. Then he's just being honest. It's just, it sounds like, get him, wow. So as soon as he says, well, you have to believe in the one whom God has sent, they say, well, what are you going to do to prove it? As in our forefathers, they were given bread by Moses. The manna came down from heaven. And again, this is, he's quite quick off the mark. He's saying, Moses did not give you manna from heaven. God gave you manna from heaven. And I am not going to give you manna from heaven. And you get to the point where he actually says it. I am the manna from heaven. I'm not going to give you the manna. I am the manna. I am the bread of life. And so in the way that you see the passage saying, you know, the followers of God in the Old Testament, they're sustained by this manna from heaven, in the same way that the 5,000 were sustained by the bread that he miraculously made feed 5,000 men and a whole bunch of other folks, female and children. What you have to recognize is he's moving it on. He's done the miracle. He's got their attention. Now, please, can we get the point of the miracle? Or are we just going to sit about and say, tomorrow, what are you giving us today? You fed us yesterday. What we get? What's on the menu for today? And you realize, Jesus, it does sound, maybe I'm wrong, I'm overreading it, but it does sound there's a certain kind of frustration that they just don't get it. Jesus is the one who's presenting himself, who sustains life in this world and the next, in the way that bread sustains people in their day. Maybe not quite the same way in our day, but still it sustains us. He is the bread of life because specifically he presents himself as the one who sustains and nourishes life physically and life eternally. The thing is, going towards the end of the passage, he specifically goes off metaphor. He stayed in this very symbolic place, but he ends up saying that you have to eat this flesh to live forever. And he's saying, I am that flesh. I am, you have to eat me to have eternal life. And so it's almost like he has to die so that they can live. And again, so that's the sense of the Good Shepherd goes right through into an envisaged sacrament of bread and wine. It shouldn't surprise us, in as much as, you know, the I am statement, I am the Good Shepherd. Again, Jesus specifically says, I am the Good Shepherd, and the shepherd lays down his life for the sheep. He's not like the hired hand. They see the wolf and they're off. The Good Shepherd lays down his life for the sheep. The Messiah sustains life, but he gives life. And in the same way as Paul talks about planting the seed, and the seed has to die so that the actual flourishing, the growth from the seed comes to life. The bread, that seed has to die such that the flour is made and the bread comes to fruition, and that bread brings life. It's all about this overblown, very big-headed, arrogant statement about the fact that it's all about him. Because he is literally saying, I sustain and give life. He shouldn't be worshipped if he's just a nice guy. But if he's just stating truth, if he is just saying, as he says in the passage, I do what I do because my Heavenly Father tells me to do it. I'm not doing it because I'm big-headed. I'm doing it because I'm told to do it. In that case, he's just stating fact. What is it that you eat that you couldn't do without? What is it that sustains you? I mean, I'm hoping it's not fish and chips from the local, you know, I'm hoping it's not McDonald's. All that kind of fast food. What comes to mind when you do get asked the question, what's your favourite food? What's your favourite snack? I guess snack's not really a good analogy, in as much as bread is chosen because Jesus is saying, this is the staple diet. This is the thing that sustains when you can't get anything else. That's who I am. That's who Jesus needs to be in our life. That's who he is, and that's who Christ, God the Father, offers Christ as his Son, as our Saviour. I'm going to come now to prayers for others, and we are going to be led this morning by Fiona.
Good morning. Prayer for others. Let us pray. Dear God, help us in our community to know that you are with us in all that we do. Let those who are worried about their health, those that are struggling to keep things going at home, those that are lonely and those that are feeling anxious about the future, be comforted and see kindness. We are praying for them. Help us to see good in people. The friendly shopkeeper who goes the extra mile to help and asks us how we are, the stranger who offers help, and the nurse that takes time to make you a lovely cup of tea. When things are difficult, help us to remember and appreciate how the little things can make life not so tough. Social distancing can make us fearful and anxious. The lack of face-to-face contact can make us feel lonely. We pray that in these challenging times we show extra kindness and are watchful for each other. Help us not to use empty words. And in moments of darkness, we pray that you are by our side to guide us. Help us to see the beautiful earth and help us change the things that lead to negativity and pain. We pray for our minister at Flemington, Ian, and the newly appointed minister, Peter Nimmel, at Cambuslang Parish Church. We pray for all faiths and political leaders. Dear God, help them to lead us at this time and help us to love one another without barriers. We pray for our world, that we are tolerant, patient and kind to each other, and that we live life as Jesus taught us. Amen.
Thank you for that, Fiona. And now we bring our service in terms of his worship to a conclusion as we sing again. It's probably another classic, but certainly one I hope you enjoy. This is Amazing Grace. Hopefully you enjoyed that last piece of worship, and now we come to this morning's benediction. Lord Jesus, we ask that you bless us. Go from this place, not only with God's understanding of what this passage means, but with that seeking after the nourishment that comes alone from Christ, so that our very soul is fed, sustained and guided. Do this such that your walk in life, be it in lockdown or without restriction, is lived to his glory. Do this as your true worship, in the name of the Father, in the name of the Son, and in the name of the Holy Spirit. And all God's people said, Amen. That's the end of the service. Surprise, surprise, that benediction probably did give it away. The last point is really just to kind of bring you up to date. We've had been conversations in the Cook session, and we've had a wee kind of subcommittee in terms of just What do we have to do to prepare the church to have an, as they say, an in-person service? On the basis that this is not an in-person service, this is a virtual service. So roughly what we're planning, I don't think we can say things with absolute guaranteed certainty, because if things change, if the virus kind of spikes in any way, or people get a bit more kind of fearful, then we're not sure. But it seems appropriate to start telling you about the kind of timetable that we're working towards. The 16th of August is when the Cook session is kind of putting penciling, I think, in the diary to say we're going to endeavour to have service for folks in the church on that particular Sunday. Now, at the moment, the distance restrictions are still in place. We would be able to get more in if it's just 1 meter that we're supposed to separate folks by, but at the moment it's still 2 meters, and it looks as if that's going to stay. It may change. The point I'm focusing on is, if we're going to keep folks 2 meters away, that means you can't sit in your pew in the church. We have to basically, for every 3 pews, we have to close off 2 of them and just use 1. Family members can sit together, but basically, if you're not in from one household, you basically have to sit 2 meters apart from everyone else. So that means basically one service would have roughly 40 folk in it. So it's not so much there's a certain number and then we stop, but it would mean once we have the requisite number of people who are the necessary distance apart from everyone else, then that mean we would have to not let anyone else in. So to get that all planned out, to deal with the kind of mitigation in terms of cleanliness and requirements, we think getting a service by the 18th of August would be where we need to be. Point being, sorry, my apologies, just got it wrong, the 16th of August. Thought it was wrong. 16th of August, so that's when we would be hopefully having a service, but because of the numbers being reduced, if it's about 40 folks, we probably need to have a service, one in the morning and one in the afternoon. It can be back to back, because after you have one service, you have to clean the places where folks have been sitting and touching and all that kind of stuff. So at the moment, I'm assuming it will be something like a younger service, a family service in the morning, and then a more traditional service in the afternoon. I don't think we're going to be allowed to worship in the sense of singing hymns or singing worship songs. So there might not be that much difference between the morning and the afternoon, but in terms of how we're trying to plan it, that's what we're endeavouring to sort of put together. I'm trying to get the date in the diary just now, because over the next few weeks people are going on holiday and there's going to be other things. So a service like the one we've had this morning, I think the last one is going to be next Sunday. That will be the 19th, and at that point, sorry, will that be the 19th? Yeah, that will be the 19th, and then at that point, I'll be on holiday for 2 Sundays, and you're going to have the moderator of the General Assembly on a kind of service like this. And every Church of Scotland minister has been given, I would say, a gift by the moderator, a guy called Martin Fair. I should just let you know, prior knowledge, letting folks know, Martin was my best man at my wedding, and we grew up in the same church. We went to the same YF. So he's a good guy. And he's even better, given what I'm about to describe. He sent big files on the internet by email. He sent 2 services so that we can have these kind of things, and ministers can go and have a holiday, which is, I thought, not only creative, but really practical as well. So there'll be one last service for myself next Sunday online, and then the two Sundays after that, that's like the last Sunday in July and the first Sunday in August, there's going to be these two services by the moderator. And then on the 9th of August, there's going to be a service with some of the young people from Canvas Lang, some of the young people from Flemington Hall side, and they'll be doing kind of stuff off the back of the, they've been having a kind of holiday club online. I'm not sure exactly what it's going to look like, but I'm sure it'll be good because it'll be Alison and Ross and folks from Canvas Lang. So that'll be on the 9th, and then, as I say, the 16th. Now, that's the plan. That's roughly what the Kirk session have kind of worked out. The reason is a problem is the virus could spike. Nicola could say things have to change. And she says, just call me Nicola. We're close. As a consequence, things may alter. I'm just mapping that out. That is what I think is going to happen in the next few weeks. So up until the 16th, there's going to be things online for you in Flemington Hall side at this particular place. So just come online, but it will be, as I say, moderated to the General Assembly or some sort of children's stuff. It will be a service. Everyone will be invited. But what I'm saying is it will be gearing up towards filling the Sundays between now and then 16th, hopefully in church. And if it all changes, then we'll try and let you know that as well. Until next week, I should say there's a kind of comment section. You can get you put the wee cursor in and there's a wee box down here. If you want to make comment or if there's things that you want to say or things that we haven't thought about and you would help, then that's fine. I know the Kirk session is wanting just to kind of make sure that they're doing what they are doing in response to what folks are actually wanting. So that's the rough timetable. Thank you very much indeed for listening. Thank you for being here. Thank you for coming along for all the Sundays that you have. One more with me and then some changes, but hopefully really good ones too. Until the next time. Bye-bye.